بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، الحمد لله. Today's lesson is actually very easy, inshallah. I do believe so, because especially the first chapter is something which we have taken before. And the Sheikh basically talks about the two conditions of the acceptance of an action. The first is ikhlas, and the second is al-mutaba'ah. The first is sincerity, doing an action only for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the second is following the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And this, especially those who have studied, you know, the different books with me, especially Aqidah books, they I'm pretty sure that they are familiar with these two concepts. So if you, so in terms of the general understanding, I think most of you would have it. But in terms of the reading the Arabic, this is where it's upon you to read. So the Shaykh, you know, the title is Fi Wujubi Ikhlas al-Amali Lillah, in regards to the obligation of making the action sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, Alhamdulillahi wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa ba'du, fa innahu yashtaritu liqabuli al-amali shartan. There are two conditions for the acceptance of an action. Ash-shartu al-awwal, the first condition, al-ikhlasu lillahi azza wa jal, that you make your action sincerely for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بأن يكون العمل مقصودا به وجه الله سبحانه وتعالى. أما إذا كان العمل غير خالص فإنه لا يقبل كما إذا كان في شرك مع الله سبحانه وتعالى. So if action is not sincerely, then it won't be accepted, such as if there is shirk in it, and it wouldn't be accepted. And the Sheikh mentions a famous ayah which is always used, and he also mentions other hadith Qudsi, that I am free from all those who commit shirk, and whoever does an action of shirk, then I have left him and his shirk. And a different narration, فَهُوَ لِلَّذِي أَشْرَكَ, then he's done the action for the person that he did the shirk for. So if he showed off, then it's for that person. And in other narrations, on day of judgment, he'll be told that go get your rewards from that person. And obviously, he won't be able to. And then the Sheikh talks about, he says, سواء كان شركا أكبر أو شركا أصغر, whether it's major or minor shirk. And we've studied the differences between major and minor shirk before, which also, so I'm not going to repeat them again, because you know, we mentioned a number of times in our Aqid lessons. However, the difference here, so the Sheikh is saying that it won't be accepted. The only difference in this scenario is that shirk akbar takes you out of the fold of Islam and it nullifies all of your actions. Whereas shirk asghar doesn't take you out of the fold of Islam and it only nullifies that action that you did that shirk asghar in. So if you prayed salah and you were showing off for your friend, then that salah is not accepted, and the shirk asghar in that salah, we still consider the Muslim, and the other actions that you did sincerely are accepted. But if you do shirk akbar, then all the actions are fully invalid. And then the Sheikh carries on talking about how it's important to have sincerity. Then he also says, وَأَنْ يَخْفِيَ عَمَالَهُ مَهْمَا إِسْتَطَعَ. A person should always try to hide his sins as much as he can, especially now with social media and stuff. It's so easy to do a good deed, but then have some sort of showing off in there because you're taking pictures. Or sometimes you do it with sincerity, but then you post about it later. And that's known as the smear. Or it could be riyah as well, where later on you're telling people about it, or later on you're showing people. So that is still a form of showing off, because even though at the time it was sincere, but you've just got rid of it by telling others now, or by showing others. Then he says, except illa al-a'mal al-lati yushra'u al-idhara. Apart from those actions where it's legislated that you make them apparent, such as praying in jama'ah and jihad, and the Sheikh mentions the hadith for it. Also, if you have the good intention that maybe I'm doing this to encourage others, so sometimes in charity events, you put your hand up first, not showing off that you're, even though charity should normally be hidden. One of the hadith from the seven who will gain the shade on the day that there is no shade, one of them is the one who gives sadaqah so and so that his left hand doesn't know what his right hand has spent. Right, but in this scenario, if you've done it so that you, if no one's donating, so that you put your hand up and donate a little bit with the intention that maybe this will encourage others, then that's fine, inshallah. And that's what actually happened in, yeah, with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In Sadaqah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that it was a. Then he said the hadith, "Man sunna fil Islami sunnatun hasana," till the end of the hadith. So whoever, you know, makes a good sunnah and people follow, then he'll get the reward of it. And even though some people have tried to use that to show that, oh, it's bid'ah hasana, what refutes is the hadith itself. The Prophet said, sunnah hasana, not bid'ah hasana. And that's because sadaqa is already something established. And the only thing his companion did is that he was the first one to give the sadaqa, so that all, and he became like a role model for the rest, and everyone has followed him. So he's going to get that reward because he encouraged everyone else. And it's not something new that he's legislated in the religion. Now, and then after that, the Sheikh towards the bottom of the page, الشرط الثاني في قبول العمل أن يكون صوابا على سنة الرسول صلى الله عليه وسلم بعيدا عن البدع والمحدثات والخرافات. الاتباع. الاتباع. فلا يتمشى مع عادات الناس. So you don't just follow what the people are doing, بل عليه أن يتبع الدليل. He follows the دليل. He follows the دليل. Now, I do want to point out that in certain issues, the norm and the customs of the people are important. That's why from the legal maxims in Qaid Fiqhiyya, we have Al-Ada Muhakkama, that we take into consideration the customs of the people. However, they're in certain issues. And normally it's in those issues where the legislation has left open and the legislation has not specified it. So for example, Allah says, وَعَاشِرُوهُنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ, and live with your wives with goodness. What does it mean with goodness? We'd say in this scenario, this goes back to the urf of the people. This goes back to the earth of the people. So whatever that community in that time and place considered to be good, then that's what a person does. And if in a different time, maybe like 100 years ago, something was considered good, and now we don't consider that good anymore. Maybe a certain type of food or whatever it may be. So in those type of issues, we take it back to the earth. But other than that, in ibadat and those things which the Sharia has clearly explained, then we don't add any new things, we don't legislate anything, we don't follow culture, but we give preference to the Quran and Sunnah. So, for example, if somebody wants to pray Salah in a certain way, we say, no, we know that Salah is prayed in a certain way due to the truth from the Quran and Sunnah, and we only add something if there is a delil. So, if you brought me an authentic hadith that I didn't know about, or something like that, then I would accept it. Otherwise, we don't accept customs. And the Sheikh carries on and he elaborates on these, and he mentions few famous hadiths which you've taken. When عَمِلَ لَيْسَ عَلَيْهِ أَمْرُنَا فَهُوَ رَدٌّ, hadith 45 نَوِيَّةٍ, عَلَيْكُمْ بِسُنَّةِ وَسُنَّةِ الْخُلَفَاءِ الرَّاشِدِينَ مَهْدِيٍ مِنْ بَعْدِي, hadith number 28 45 نَوِيَّةٍ, and so on. نعم. Here the Sheikh mentions the end of Surah Fatiha, which is a nice benefit, and we did mention this in our Tafsir of Fatiha and Qasar al-Mufassal when we explained Surah Fatiha, and we did do Surah Fatiha in depth, so please do go back to those notes because they were quite, you know, I think we took two or three lessons just on Surah Fatiha, so it does require some sort of revision. But when we make dua, oh Allah, guide us to a straight path, the path of those you have bestowed your favor upon, and that's basically, we said the prophets and the martyrs and the pious people and so on, and the first people that enter into that are the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. Well, the first people are the prophets. From then, Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And then also the Sahaba radiallahu anhum. So in there, it's like an indication that we actually make dua, and it's a dua to follow the sunnah upon understanding of the Salaf. Subhanallah. Now. And then, the Shaykh, you know, carries on. And then at the end, he just finishes talking about, he says, وَالْيَوْمَ الْمُبْتَدِعَةُ لَهُمْ نَشَاطٌ, that they have, the mubtadi'a, the people of bid'ah have a lot of activities going on, they're very active. يُوَزِّعُونَ كُتُبًا وَيَنْشُرُونَ مَقَالَاتٍ وَيَخْطُبُونَ وَيَتَحَدَّثُونَ, they give out books and they write articles and they give khutbas and they talk and so on. So, you know, they're very active, so we should be more active in applying, in learning the sunnah, acting upon it, and also teaching and spreading it to others. That's regarding this chapter. The next chapter, the Sheikh talked about the virtues of building a masajid. And the Sheikh basically splits this chapter into two. First, he talks about some couple of, you know, ayahs, about hadith regarding generally the virtues of building masajid. And then he talks about masajid themselves. And then he mentions, إِنَّمَا يَعْمُرُ مَسَاجِدِ اللَّهِ, the one who builds the houses of Allah. And he mentions a few more acts of worship. Then he says, أُولَى فَعَسَىٰ أُولَٰئِكَ أَن يَكُونُوا مِنَ الْمُهْتَدِينَ, they are the ones who are guided. So from guidance, you know, if you want to get guidance, one of the ways is building masajid. And then the Sheikh, he says building masajid is of two types. First is bitini wa mawad al-bina, with clay and, you know, with all the instruments that you would need to build for buildings, cement, and all of that. And he says this is actually a wasila, but this is ghaya. This is actually a means and not the objective. The actual objective is the second half of building. That's why he says wahiya al-ghaya. Imaratuha bi-ta'ah wa dhikrillah. They build it upon obedience and the dhikr of Allah. That's why after in this ayah I mentioned previously, Inna ya Umar sajidullah, Sheikh brings it again. And he mentions all these good deeds after that. So that's very important, because what a lot of people do is that they build masajid, they build massive masajid, and then there's nothing going on. There's no dhikr of Allah, there's no obedience, there's no classes, there's no teaching of tawheed, there's none of this stuff. And they've just done it, just maybe show off that we've made this masjid or whatever the case may be. And the Shaykh's going to talk about that, and it does go back to being sincere as well. And then the Shaykh mentions the hadith, Man bana lillahi masjidan bana Allahu lahu baytan fil jannah in-nasa'i, that whoever builds for Allah a house, lillah, for Allah, bana Allahu lahu baytan fil jannah, Allah will make for him a house in Jannah. The Shaykh says, notice Allah saying, bana lillah, for Allah. So your intention has to be for Allah, not for showing off or for praise or anything like that. And then that's why he mentions that this is why the masjid of the Prophet is the best place after Masjid Haram. Because it's the first masjid which is built upon taqwa, huwa an masjid Quba. So when Allah says the masjid usisa ala taqwa, some narrations is mentioned masjid Nabawi, and some narrations is mentioned masjid Quba, that these are built upon piety, sincerity, ta'a, worship of Allah. That's why they're from the best places for a person to pray in. Now, and he mentions a few of the virtues of masjid Nabawi, such as you get reward more than 1,000 times and so on. And then he says, so the فَالْعِبْرَ لَيْسَ بِمَتَانَةِ الْبِنَاءِ. So the point is not, you know, how well you've made it, but it's to do with the niyyah wal qasd, the intention behind it, and that is establishing the worship of Allah and the tawheed of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then he gives the example of Masjid Dirar. Masjid Dirar was a masjid that the Munafiqun built with evil intention. So what actually happened is that the Prophet was commanded never to pray in there, and in fact, the Prophet actually is commanded, and he did destroy it, because the masjid was built upon with the correct intention, nor was it built upon obedience. And then the Sheikh talks about the importance of masajid, and he says, وَيَكُونُ هَذَا الْمَكَانَ لِعِبَادَةِ اللَّهِ وَتَعَلِيمِ الْعَمَلِ النَّافِعِ وَالدُّرُوسِ الْمُفِيدَةِ وَيَقَامِ الصَّلَاةِ وَإِيتَاءِ الزَّكَاةِ, that this place will be for the worship of Allah and teaching beneficial knowledge, or beneficial actions and beneficial lessons, and establishing prayer, giving zakah, ويكون محل إشعاع النور على البلد, and a place of spreading light in the land, وعلى الحارة هكذا تكون مساجد. This is how the masajid are. فالمساجد لها حرمتها. The masjid has حرمة, it's sacred. ولها مكانتها, and it has a station. ولها عظمتها, and it's glorified. Masajid are not like normal places. فهي أفضل البقاع, and it's best of places. Like in the hadith, the best places are the masajid, and the worst are the markets. يجب أن تعظم وأن تصان وأن تحترم. So you have to venerate these places and protect these places and have respect for these places. وأن لا يساء الأدب فيها, and not to have bad manners in this. وأن لا يرفع الكلام فيها, and not to raise your voice. So Sheikh is talking about the importance of masajid now, and how it's different to other places. And the Sheikh, he continues to talk about that issue. And he says, وَهِيَ مَحَلُّ إِجْتِمَاعِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, and he said the Muslims got together. And that's why you're not allowed to come to the masajid with bad odor, it's disliked. And also it's a place where the malaika come down. And the Sheikh mentions a few more virtues of masajid. And he also mentioned the hadith that one of the people that would be under shade on that day where there was no shade. And by the way, that shade, in another narration, it mentions that it's the shade of, when you say shade of Allah, it doesn't mean that Allah himself has a shade or a shadow. And another narration clarifies it, which is that it's actually the shade of the arsh. So we don't say that Allah has a shade, it's the shade of the arsh. And that, you know, kind of when you would, like we say, the house of Allah. You know, whenever we attribute something to Allah, there's two types. If it's an attribute, we attribute to Allah, then that's an attribute. So we say, Sama' Allah, the hearing of Allah, that's his attribute. But if you attribute a creation to Allah, then it's different meaning. We don't say it's an attribute. We say it's a creation of Allah. Masajidullah, it's a creation of Allah. And that's normally, why is it attributed to Allah? Out of tashrif and takrim, out of honoring that thing which has been attributed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And we'll take this in more depth in Kitab al-Tawheed, inshallah. Now, and Sheikh just carries on to talk about the importance of masajid and how important they are and their status. With that, we come to the conclusion of this lesson. Subhanallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.